Welcome to this service, wherever you're watching, a service prepared for the York Methodist Circuit for the 15th of November. We are using some of last Sunday's lectionary readings, as many people used different passages appropriate for Remembrance Sunday last week. The preacher today is Mr. Brian Taylor, one of our circuit's local preachers. As we begin, we acknowledge the presence of the living God wherever we are at this moment, and we bring our worship with the hymn, Rejoice, the Lord is King, your Lord and King adore. Reading from Psalm 78, the first seven verses. Give ear, O my people, to my teaching. Incline your ears to the words of my mouth. I will open my mouth in a parable. I will utter dark sayings from of old, things that we have heard and known, that our ancestors have told us. We will not hide them from their children. We will tell to the coming generation the glorious deeds of the Lord and his might and the wonders that he has done. He established a decree in Jacob and appointed a law in Israel, which he commanded our ancestors to teach to their children, that the next generations might know them, the children yet unborn, and rise up and tell them to their children, so that they should set their hope in God and not forget the works of God, but keep his commandments. Let us pray. Living God, our Lord and King, in whose name we rejoice, we bring our worship and praise to you today. We acknowledge you to be a God of power, of truth and holiness, grace and compassion. You come to us, part of your creation, and invite us to respond to you in love and obedience. We thank you for your goodness to us, for Jesus, his life and ministry, his death and resurrection, and the promise of his return. We thank you for your Holy Spirit, who comforts and challenges us, and who helps us to serve you. We ask your forgiveness for the times when we forget you, or allow other priorities to distract us from your way. Forgive us for our lack of love for you and for others, for being reticent in sharing your good news, and for ignoring those words of the psalmist that said, "We will tell to the coming generation the glorious deeds of the Lord and his might and the wonders that he has done." We pray that you will help us to become beacons of light and hope to every generation, so that they should set their hope in God and not forget the works of God, but keep his commandments. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. For Christ's sake, Amen.
Reading from the letter is from 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verses 13 to 15. Brothers, we do not want you to be ignorant about those who fall asleep, or to grieve like the rest of men who have no hope. We believe that Jesus died and rose again, and so we believe that God will bring with Jesus those who have fallen asleep in him. According to the Lord's own word, we tell you that we who are still alive, who are left till the coming of the Lord, will certainly not precede those who have fallen asleep. For the Lord himself will come down from heaven with a loud command, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trumpet call of God. And the dead in Christ will rise first. After that, we who are still alive and are left will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so we will be with the Lord forever. Therefore, encourage each other with these words.
My reason. Our gospel reading is taken from the Gospel of St. Matthew, chapter 25, and the first 13 verses. It's entitled The Parable of the Ten Virgins. At that time, the kingdom of heaven will be like 10 virgins who took their lamps and went out to meet the bridegroom. Five of them were foolish, and five were wise. The foolish ones took their lamps, but did not take any oil with them. The wise, however, took oil in jars along with their lamps. The bridegroom was a long time in coming, and they all became drowsy and fell asleep. At midnight, the cry rang out, "Here's the bridegroom, come out to meet him." Then all the virgins woke up and trimmed their lamps. The foolish ones said to the wise, "Give us some of your oil, our lamps are going out." "No," they replied, "there may not be enough for both us and you. Instead, go to those who sell oil and buy some for yourselves." But while they were on their way to buy the oil, the bridegroom arrived. The virgins who were ready went in with him to the wedding banquet, and the door was shut. Later, the others also came. "Sir, sir," they said, "open the door for us." But he replied, "I tell you the truth, I don't know you. Therefore, keep watch, because you do not know the day or the hour." Amen.
Each Christmas, my wife prepares me for the coming year by treating me to an LWPT diary. It has lots of useful information, such as the telephone number for tourist information on the Isle of Man, and at its back, it prints the lectionary readings appointed for each Sunday. But this year, something went wrong. When I looked at 15 November, the readings that I quoted to Ruth for the today turned out to be the passages set for last Sunday. Since our God never makes mistakes and all things work together for good, I can only conclude that the passages read for us earlier by David and Linda are definitely the ones that we should be considering today. Our theme can be summed up in two words, words familiar with scouts all over the world: be prepared. There's an old story going back to the days of telegrams that tells of the university student who had failed his end of first year exams. He wired his mother to say, "Terrible results, stop. Sorry, stop. Prepare, father." His mother's reply did nothing to reassure him. It read, "Father prepared, stop. Prepare yourself. Be prepared." Matthew's gospel is well known to have whole blocks of Jesus' teaching lumped together. The passage about the girls preparing to meet the bridegroom comes in the middle of two chapters of teaching about what lies in store, in particular for his immediate hearers and their beloved temple, but also generally for what we call the end times. Two questions are asked at the start of this section. When will the destruction of the temple take place? And what will be the sign of your coming and the end of the age? As ever, Jesus' answers are not straightforward and include references to scripture, intermingled with specific facts and parables. His answers, pick up on two themes that run through chapters 24 and 25, and neither one is a popular subject today, even among Christians. The first is Jesus' return to earth, and the second is judgment. Very few people accept that life itself is a gift for which one day we will all be accountable to the giver. Think of the 1972 play, later converted to both film and novel in 1981, about a man who was paralyzed from the neck down and wanted to die. The powerful script reignited a debate about euthanasia. Its very title was a challenge. Whose life is it anyway? A question that remains an issue today. You may have read this week about Joy Munns. She is the daughter of a woman who was recently cleared of murdering her terminally ill husband in a mercy killing. Joy is now campaigning for the laws on assisted dying to be changed, so, quote, no family has to go through what we did, unquote. In September, a jury finally cleared her 80-year-old mother, Mavis Eccleston, of the murder and manslaughter of her husband Dennis, aged 81. You may also have read that there is an exemption from the current lockdown ban on travel. It's okay if you want to travel abroad for the purpose of assisted dying. Coming back to our basic theme of being prepared and the twin themes of judgment and the second coming, we note that this section of Matthew ends with the parable of the sheep and the goats, which has inspired many hymns and songs, not least Sidney Carter's "When I Needed a Neighbour, Were You There?" The underlying message for followers of Jesus, both then and now, is that what we do with this life, and specifically how we treat our neighbour, will have repercussions on the day of judgment. And once again, the watchword is, be prepared. So heed the Christmas cracker advice, never challenge death to a pillow fight, unless you're prepared for the repercussions. This is not to be interpreted as earning eternal life by doing good deeds. On the contrary, it is experiencing the life-changing spiritual rebirth where we can say with St. Paul, I have been crucified with Christ. The life I now live is not my life, but the life which Christ lives in me. Has there ever been a greater time when disciples need to show their love for God by loving their neighbour than in the pain, confusion, isolation, and outright fear that grips our nation today? To speak of judgment and the second coming is neither pit dangling nor pie in the sky. It is part of being prepared and preparing others. Neither the second coming nor judgment is to be feared. On the contrary, the new life that will follow our resurrection is the great hope of the Christian. Paul positively welcomes the prospect of a time when we shall always be with the Lord, as we heard earlier. Peter reminds the scattered church that by the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, he gave us new birth into a living hope, the hope of an inheritance reserved in heaven for you. And John assures us in his gospel that no one who puts his faith in him, that is Jesus, comes under judgment, And again in his first letter, this is how love has reached its perfection among us, so that we may have confidence on the day of judgment. And this we can have, because in this world we are as he is. We return to our lampholders, awaiting the return of the bridegroom. And their tragedy, the tragedy for five of them, was that the long wait had left them unprepared and literally shut out of the banquet that other guests and servants were enjoying. We do not have time to explore the wedding banquet theme that recurs in other parables and, of course, in our greatly missed service of Holy Communion. But the penalty of being unprepared is a sobering message that is repeated by Jesus in similar parables and illustrations. The householder who would have stayed awake if he had known what time the burglar would call. The bad steward, caught in the act of bullying and carousing by a master who returned on a day when his servant did not expect him. The people of Noah's time, who were eating, drinking, marrying, and generally carrying on with life unsuspecting until the flood swept them away. We started with the scout's motto, "Be prepared." Let's close by remembering the sign that is engraved on Lord Baden-Powell's gravestone. Simply a circle with a dot in the centre. The scouting sign that says, "Gone home." May we be prepared for that day when Jesus either comes or calls, and meanwhile carry on his kingdom work of preparing others for that day. Amen. We could have sung a hymn about going home, moving on, set to the Dvorak's New World Symphony tune, but I've chosen instead 407 in Singing the Faith, because verse 3 says, "Hear the call of the kingdom to reach out to the lost with the Father's compassion in the wonder of the cross, bringing peace and forgiveness and a hope yet to come. Let the nations put their trust in him." We sing.
And a hope yet to come. Let the
As we now turn to our prayers, I begin by reading some of a Charles Wesley hymn, numbered 741 in Singing the Faith. We pray until the hour, that awesome hour unknown, when robed in majesty and power, you shall from heaven come down. O Christ, our soul, prepare for that tremendous day, and fill us now with watchful care, and stir us up to pray. At last, may we be found obedient to your word, attentive to the judgment sounds, and looking for our Lord's. And so, as we are now stirred up to pray, we pray for others. And as we do, let us be open to how the Holy Spirit may prompt us and then be prepared to act. Compassionate God, we bring to you those whom we know who are struggling with life. We think of family members, friends, neighbours, and the wider community. Perhaps they have physical or mental health concerns, financial worries, be suffering from isolation or loneliness, abuse or relationship issues. We pray for your healing, love, and peace. All-knowing God, we pray for our country as the lockdown continues. We thank you for the prospect of a vaccination for COVID-19 soon. And we pray for the NHS, which is under so much pressure. We think of the doctors, nurses, and other staff who work such long hours. For other carers, for emergency services, where forced absenteeism due to isolation needs places even more pressure on those remaining. We pray for those who carry on as they want, with no thought for others. We pray for the Prime Minister, for the governments and their advisers who make the decisions that affect us all. And we pray for strength for the exhausted, rest for the weary, and wisdom for all. Gracious God, we pray for the world that you have made, a world that is marred by greed and division, hate and despair. We pray that your light will shine in the dark places, that in the silence we name before you now. Loving Father, as your children, we pray for our brothers and sisters as together we make up your church. Help us to find ways to share your love and light where we are, in whatever way we can. Help us to stay connected to you and to each other. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And we say together the Lord's Prayer. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Our final hymn speaks of that blessed assurance that we have, knowing that Jesus is ours. Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine.
Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Heir of salvation, purchase of God, born of His Spirit, washed in His blood. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior.
So may the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make His face to shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look on you with kindness and give you peace, now and always. Amen.